Bible says, prepare to meet God. Am I right about it? We need to be sure when we meet God. You know, I've heard people say that, oh, you're going to be saved. He said, I hope to be saved. Or I think I'm saved. You see, you need to be sure about this thing. Why? Because God is sure when we stand before him. And we hear him say, depart from iniquity. I never knew you. That's a surety that you're not going to make it in. So understand, without a shadow of a doubt, we are going to be judged one at a time. In other words, God is going to judge everyone according to his will. If we have not done his will, the Bible said over there in the book of Hebrews, but it says that sacrifices and offerings, thou wouldst not. See, say, but obedience. God wants obedience. So if you obey, you're going to have to do what the book says. How can you do what the book says when you don't know what the book is saying? And
right.
We studied this morning, we said, we need to give the boys heed to the thing which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Again, I said, move on over to 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. Study to show thyself approved unto God. Work that need not to be ashamed, but uprightly dividing the word of truth. Let me drop down to verse number 19, if you don't mind. He said, for the foundation of God standing sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. Everyone that nameth the name of Christ, let him depart from iniquity. God is keeping a record of every last one of us. Don't worry about the way I think I can get by. Get by what? He said, understand that it will be no getting by. God, I can't find way. God said, you might get by. Nowhere in the Bible. If it might be in your Bible, you need to let me know, because I want to know if I can get by. I don't think I can, but if you can show it to me in your book, I might believe it. I said, I might believe it. Get it? All right. Therefore, as I move on, I want you to go with me, if you don't mind, brother, to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and wait for me at verse number 23. Brother George, if you get the book, I want you to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse number 23, and wait for me. I want you to understand that this book talks about the Lord's Supper, and the Lord's Supper is important, because if you don't do it right, you will not have no life in you. So therefore, if we do it right, then God is pleased and heaven is satisfied. In 1 Corinthians, I believe it is, in chapter 11 and verse 23, I think that's what I want. If you haven't read, let's see what it said.
For I receive from the Lord.
Yeah, that's what I want first.
What
I receive. What Paul said, for I receive from the Lord. Where did he get it, Paul? He said, I got it from the Lord. Okay. See, the Bible is what we have gotten from the Lord. Yes. When we stand before God and they tell us to, we need to have pity, it came from the Lord. Yes. And when they tell that we need to love one another, it came from the Lord. Whatever it says, that we might be saved, it came from the Lord. As I received from the Lord, read.
That the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed,
on the night
took
that,
bread.
On the night that he was betrayed, took bread. Read.
And when he had given thanks,
all right,
he broke it,
mm-hmm,
and said,
what
take.
Is, all right, he said, now take, read.
Eat.
Take it, eat.
This is my body.
All right.
Which is broken for you.
All right.
Do this in remembrance of me.
Do this in remembrance of me. You know, folk, let me slow walk you just a little bit. Folk will come to the service. Sure. They'll eat up all the bread.
Mm.
Drink up all the juice.
Mm.
Soak up all the affirmation.
Mm.
Wear out the cushion seats.
Mm.
Get on up and go home.
Mm.
I told you it wouldn't be a car. Yes, sir. You see, I'm a member of the IDC. Got it? Now, get it? Thank you. I'm a member of the IDC. I started that thing out there in California, and everybody started. I started it in Midland, and they were doing it. I started it in Arizona, and they're doing it.
All right.
And they want me to come to Arizona and Midland. I've gotten calls already. To come to Midland. Lord have mercy. They must don't know how old I am. Let me move on. What else does it say?
In the same way, also he took the bread, the cup.
Mm-hmm.
After such saying,
yes.
This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in the remembrance of me.
He said, do this.
Yes, sir.
This cup.
Yes,
hold the blood. Mm-hmm. And the New Testament of Christ. But the denominational world hangs up on do this. It says, well, as often as you do this. And they say, well, we do it once a month. Once every 6 months. Or not at all. But then the Bible says, as often. How often did they do it in the New Testament? On the first day of the week. When the disciples came together to break bread. Paul preached unto them. Same thing I'm doing right now is what he did then. Same thing what we're going to do in just a few minutes from now. Observe the Lord's Supper. And it is important that we have our, well, I don't want to get ahead of me. What else did you say?
Well, as often as you eat this bread,
yes.
Drink the cup.
All right.
You proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Every time we eat the loaf, and drink of the blood,
yes, sir.
We proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And we proclaim it every Lord's day.
Amen.
Get it?
Amen.
We understand that if you want to go to heaven, you know, there's a lot of folks that play in church. But see, hell's not going to play. Now, if you don't think hell's a plane, you turn to the 16th chapter of the book of Luke.
Amen. The rich man in life.
And talk to the rich man.
Amen.
The Bible says that the rich man died. And in hell, he lifted up his eyes. But then he started to do some personal word thinking. When? After he was dead. We have to do the personal work while we are living.
Right.
Jesus told his disciples, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth is baptized shall be saved. Do that while you are living.
Amen.
But if you don't, if they don't obey the gospel, if you're not baptized, they will not be saved. I heard that preacher say the other day that he was on death row. Well, I stopped by to tell you this morning that I want to go just a little further than that. You see, if a person have not obeyed the gospel of the Son of God, he is automatically on death row. Do you hear me?
Yes,
let me go one more step further. If a person being a member of the church and don't live right, he is outside, he's been put outside. The Bible says that God, in the end, God is going to send forth his angels. And he's going to take them out of the church, all that offend and do iniquity.
Right.
When he do that, they are on death row.
Amen.
Get it?
Amen.
Let me tell you something, church, and I'm coming to a close. This is important. It is, I'm not a long-winded preacher. I'm not cutting on Brother Frazier because he's been preaching for years. And, well, I ain't gonna bother.
All right.
He preaches his way, I preach his way. I can't preach like him, and he don't preach like me. But church, this is important.
Yes.
This is life-giving.
Yes.
As I said a few moments ago, sometimes we handle these containers like in somebody's kitchen. Lord have mercy. Bumping the containers all together, making all the noise. I know it's a young folk who do it, but it's not their fault. It's the old folk's fault for not teaching them. We need to teach our young folk how to be serious about this matter. If they find that we are nonchalant, they will be nonchalant. We need to be serious. Because dying is serious.
Yes.
I heard a man say one time, there are two things that's a fact, brother, in life. And that's death and taxes.
Amen.
And that is right. You're going to pay your taxes if you work, and you're going to die if you live.
All right.
Just don't die. Just don't die out of Christ.
Reach the truth.
Don't die out of Christ. Don't die on death row. Once you die on death row, there's no getting out. If you're here this morning, for some reason you have not obeyed the truth, you need to become a member of the Church of Christ. Because the Bible says, Jesus told the disciples, go ye therefore and teach all nations. Teach them what? Teach them the gospel. Teach them the word of God. Then after you have taught them, you baptize them. And then when you baptize them, you teach them again the word of God. You teach them. There is a continual teaching of the word of God. See, you never graduate from the Bible.
Amen.
If you took 40 men, 1,600 years to write the Bible, nobody gonna stay here 75, 85, 100 years and know it all. But you need to know enough to be saved. Get it? Need you to understand if you want to go to heaven. You got to hear God's word, you got to believe it. Repent of your sin and confess that you believe it. Jesus Christ is God's Son.
Yes.
And then be buried in a watery grave of baptism for the remission of your sin. What does baptism do? Baptism puts money into Christ.
Amen.
Know ye not that so many of us have been baptized into Christ and put on Christ.
Yes.
When you baptize, you put on Christ. And not only that, but baptism removes you from an unsaved state to a saved state.
Amen.
It tells you, it moves you from the devil's kingdom to the Lord's kingdom.
Amen.
Get it?
Amen.
When you get into the Lord's kingdom, stay there.
Yes.
Heaven will be yours to enjoy.
Yes, sir.
You remember the church stepped outside. It's not so bad to step outside, but it's even worse if you don't come back in.
Right.
Once you come back in, live right, God said, I'll give you a crown that faded not away.
Yes.
If such be your condition at this time, we'll give you the opportunity to come as we should be able to stand and sing the invitation song.
He'll say,
I'm
this might be stress, but I know God can fix everything.
Anyone else? Let us pray. Most holy, all wise, everlasting Father, the Creator and the Sustainer of all things, it is before thee and in thy divine presence that we've come this morning, thanking you for the many blessings. zero in Matthew 26. 26 through 28. It will be our study together this morning. Which reads as follows. Verse 26, it says, "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body.'" 27. "And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, 'Drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sin.'" Let me include verse 29. "But I say unto you that I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom."
All right.
I would like to announce my subject of taking of these scriptures, eating at the King's table. Eating at the King's table. You know, in putting this lesson together, reading, I thought about President Obama. If he were putting on a supper and invited everybody, we would all dress up as when I was a kid, the older folk used to say, put on our Sunday go meeting. We put on our best. Why? Because I'm having dinner or supper with President Obama. But I stopped by to tell you today that there's one greater.
All right.
Than President Obama. And that is Christ Jesus. Instituting the Last Supper. And you know, I see sometimes throughout the year, people just take this as a regularity.
All right.
I stopped by to tell you this morning that this is very important. Because Jesus said, "I'm giving my blood and my body for many." And then when I think about that, I think about the time when he was out there with the disciples in John chapter 6. And he was lecturing unto them. And he told them, "Except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you will have no life in you."
Amen. All right.
When they conspired among themselves and said, this man's trying to make a cannibal out of us in so many ways. So the Bible says many of them left. They turned to the 12 who were still there. And he said unto them, will you also go? Peter said, to whom shall we go?
All right.
Thou hast the words of eternal life. This morning, I want to know, to whom shall we go?
All right, preacher.
Or to whom can we go? Because Jesus has the words of eternal life. He said, if you drink my blood and eat my body, if you don't do it, you won't have it, eternal life. Christian friend, this morning, I want to tell you that we are eating this morning at the King's table.
All right. Yes,
Jesus said, whenever two or three gather together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. We handle these emblems as if it was a nothing, so to speak. I don't want to personalize anybody, but I think we should become more serious about what we do. When we gather around the table to serve, I notice that there's a lot of unnecessary noise being made. The containers are bumping together. Y'all don't hear me? And we seem to think that this is just another incident. I sort of feel like Green this morning when I say, get it? Thank you. Jesus said, this is my body. And this is my blood. He said, if you don't take it, you will have no life in you. He's talking about spiritual life. Some of us are concerned about things of the world. That roast you left at home on the stove. And we got stoves now with brains. I'm wondering if you're going to burn. Well, you need to understand that God gave you the money to buy the roast in the first place.
Amen.
If it burns, he'll give you some more money. But don't put the roast.
Amen, brother.
In the head of God.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, there's nothing in between God and your soul. Salvation. Because the Bible said God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
Yeah.
I understand that many of us are not so much as concerned, really, about our soul. Why do you say that, Brother Stewart? You see, I got a couple of calls for a lectureship next year. And I have created a club. And that club, the initials are IDC, are the initials of that club. You'll say, Brother Stewart, what does those initials stand for? They stand for I don't care what people say about me.
Right.
I've reached the age that I can say what I want to say.
Right.
And I'm not worried about anybody successfully contradicting me. Because I'm staying with the Bible, the Word of God. You may not like what I said, but I said it anyhow. Because the Bible is right and cannot be wrong. When you come to worship, there are certain things you need to leave outdoors. If you've got some malice in your heart, you need to leave it outside. If you've got a little envy in your heart, you need to leave it outside. If you got a little hatred in your heart, you need to leave it outside. If you got some strife in your heart, you need to leave it outside and worship God. Because the Bible said he that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God is a God who's full of compassion, and he's full of love. He's also full of fire. He will send you to hell, and don't worry about it. Because the Bible says that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. This may not be a popular sermon, but I'm not clamoring for popularity. I'm simply telling you like it is. Because I will be held responsible for telling the truth. Am I right about it? And if you hear the truth, you will be held responsible for not obeying it. And men, brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. If we're going to serve God, you got to have some backbone. Folk are going to talk about you, but it doesn't make any difference. Why? Because I'm a member of the IDC club. And it really doesn't matter what folks say about me. Because they talked about Jesus. And they're right about it. And yet, when he hanged on the cross, as he was hanging there, he said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. I can only pray for you. Am I right about it? And I do it every day for this congregation because we need prayer. This church needs prayer. Let me tell you something else. That there are those who are here this morning won't be back today, tonight rather. You see, Jesus said, wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. See, there are some people who really feel like whatever they want to do at night is much more important than meeting with Jesus. When you understand you are going to have to meet him in the final consummation. As I said before this morning, in our Bible study, I said the Bible says that God, who at certain time let diamond matters, spake in time past to the Father by the prophet, has in the last day spoken unto us by his Son. John chapter 12 in verse number 48, the Bible said, he that rejected me, Jesus said, he that rejected me and received not my word, has one that judges him. The word that I've spoken, the same shall judge you in the last day. That Bible, that 66 that you carry around, that's called the Holy Bible, is going to meet us again in the day of judgment. We need to be sure. As James said, we need to make your calling and election sure. We need to be sure that we're standing on solid foundation. See, we're standing on a sandy foundation. Sand will erode, sand will move. So therefore, we need to stand on a solid foundation. We need to stand on a clay foundation. Why? Because clay don't move. We need to be sure that we're standing on God, holy and eternal truth. The only way we can do that is stand according to God's will. And Jesus said, I will not eat of the fruit of the vine until I eat it new in my Father's house. She's willing to understand without a shadow of a doubt that we're going to have to meet God face in face. We need to be prepared.